It's the stuff you see in movies, a dystopia where robots evolve past humans and wipe us all out. Except what's happening right now isn't fantasy. The so-called godfather of AI is warning that an end to humanity is a real risk. And he's just quit his job at Google to warn us. Geoffrey Hinton, a renowned researcher who created the technology that became the foundation for AI, says we are in danger. The advances he thought would take 50 years or longer are now at our doorstep, bringing us closer to what he calls a nightmare scenario. Joining me now is the godfather of AI, chief scientific advisor of the Vector Institute and former vice president and engineering fellow at Google, Dr. Geoffrey Hinton. Doctor, thanks for being with us. Your interview in the New York Times was scary. I just want to ask you, why now? Why not? What happened in the last year that made this so urgent for you?
So for a long time, I was working on making computer models that got more and more intelligent in an attempt to understand what went on in the brain. And very recently, I realized that the computer models we're now making may actually be a better form of intelligence than what's going on biologically. So the idea that they might overtake us quite soon suddenly became much more plausible. For a long time, I'd said that would be 30 to 50 years, but now I think it may only be a few years.
What are you scared of happening if they do get smarter than us in a few years?
So the reason I'm talking out now is because we need to think really hard now about how we're going to control something that's more intelligent than us. Nobody's put enough thought into that. We don't know if there's a simple way to do it. It's not like climate change, where you can say, if you stopped burning carbon, you'd solve the problem. There isn't a simple solution like that here. But not enough people are thinking about it, and not enough resources are going into thinking about it. And that's why I'm speaking out.
So there were a couple of letters signed by more than 1,000 tech leaders to temporarily pause AI because of what they say are the profound risks to society and humanity. The 19 members of the Association for the Advancement of Artificial Intelligence signed an open letter also warning of AI's risk. This is serious stuff, profound risk to society and humanity. You're on my show warning about it now. You're doing interviews. What can be done? How urgent is this? When you talk about climate change, you say it's not quite the same, but climate activists who see the world as under serious and dire threat are going to extreme lengths to protest and try to get the public to pay attention. What should be happening now to get the public to pay attention to this?
Well, I think we understand climate change much better than we understand this. Having things that are more intelligent than us, it's not certain they'll arrive, but there's a good chance they'll arrive, and there's a good chance they'll arrive in the next decade. That's completely new territory. Things are incredibly uncertain, and not nearly enough thinking has been done about how we're going to keep them under control.
So who does this thinking? Is it the leaders of Google, the leaders of Microsoft? Is it governments? Who do you think should be responsible for putting this pause on it, to think long and hard about what it might do to all of us?
I'm not actually calling for a pause on it, because I think that's completely unrealistic. If the US paused, China wouldn't pause. Mm. And it's inevitably going to be developed more because it's so useful. This could cause incredibly good things. It'd be much nicer to see a family doctor who'd seen 100 million patients, including many with exactly your symptoms, than see a family doctor who's only seen a few thousand patients. It could make medicine much, much better. It could make more or less everything much better. And that's one of the reasons is not people aren't going to stop developing it. But we should be thinking very hard, and all the people you mentioned, governments, leaders of big tech companies, and scientists, should be thinking very hard about how we can keep it under control. And it's not certain that we can, but obviously we need to try.
I know you had a conversation with the CEO of Google as you were leaving, and the Times said you weren't going to divulge details of that conversation. I'm going to presume you won't divulge them to me either, but I just want to ask you, did that conversation leave you feeling more hopeful or more pessimistic?
It actually left me feeling more hopeful. The CEO of Google is very well aware of these things, and Google has actually been very responsible. They had a big lead in this area. In 2017, they developed transformers, which are the basis of a lot of this stuff, and also diffusion models. And they didn't put it out there. But now that Microsoft has put it out there so that people can use it, Google is going to compete with them. That's capitalism. You're not going to stop that. What's important is, before it gets more intelligent than us, we need to put a lot of work into thinking how we might control it.
It's inevitably, if it's out there, going to fall into the hands of people who maybe don't have the same values, the same motivations, the same goals. How do you stop it? Is it possible to stop it or to control it if it falls into the wrong hands?
I don't think it's possible to stop people like Putin using it for bad things. But what I'm talking about is the existential threat of this kind of digital intelligence taking over from biological intelligence. And for that threat, all of us are in the same boat. The Chinese, the Americans, the Russians are all in the same boat. We do not want digital intelligence to take over from biological intelligence. And that's much more like it was with nuclear weapons, that everybody realized that if there's a global nuclear war, we all lose. And that was sufficient to get people to cooperate. Mm. It's going to be harder here because it's harder to do verification here. But maybe that's a ray of hope.
You talk about three different phases of worry you have. And in the short term, you talk about disinformation and misinformation. And we are already seeing the development with artificial intelligence of images of humans, of people that look like humans. And there are some subtle ways you can see that they're not. They have too many fingers or too many teeth, or just created imagery that didn't exist. You know, images of pink taxicabs, as Scott Pelley did on 60 Minutes. How do you, as a regular consumer out there of the internet, of information, how do you tell what's real and what's fake? How will you be able to tell what's real and what's fake?
So I think one thing governments could do with regulation is insist that you're not allowed to put out voices or images or text without making it perfectly clear that it was generated by a computer rather than being real.
So government regulations, do you think the governments have the ability to pass legislation like that? Do they understand it enough to get their heads around it?
Well, my worry is that the government doesn't even seem to be able to stop giving assault rifles to teenage boys, which seems to me a no-brainer. And if they can't do that, this is a much more difficult problem, so that worries me.
Well, I mean, they'll argue that's the Second Amendment, so it's intractable. Geoffrey Hinton, Dr. Geoffrey Hinton, thank you very much for joining us and for issuing this warning that you have here on the show. We appreciate your time.
Thank you for inviting me.